for this wonderful introduction, and I wish to thank all the participants. And as you say, tonight we will be talking about something that more or less is of interest to all of us, not only to those of us who are above 60, but also to those who are younger, because brain aging and the pathology that is called Alzheimer's, unfortunately, is of everyone's interest. Before we start, however, we have to always state a disclaimer saying that the following are academic and scientific considerations. They are not medical prescriptions, neither medical advices. Please notice that some of the results reported in this talk have been observed in different countries in the world. And please check with your national health authorities for the current legal situation concerning some of the approaches described in this talk. And also please notice that none of the information that will be presented here has to be interpreted as a cure or as a prevention for Alzheimer's or any other disease. Well, this having said, let's first of all clarify that Alzheimer's disease and brain aging are not the same thing, even though they do share a number of features in common. And as it always happens, by studying the disease, we also can learn about the physiology of aging. And by trying to slow down the progression of the disease, we may learn a number of things about slowing down the process, the physiological process of brain aging. Actually, I began my research in the field of neurosciences in the mid-80s when I was working at the University of Florence, Italy, together with my colleagues Corradetti and Chiarugi. And in those days, we were working on a particular area of the brain that is called the hippocampus. The hippocampus is where learning and memories are controlled. So the hippocampus is not the seat of memories, but it is an important area of the brain to understand the molecular mechanisms that underlie the processes of learning and memory. And in 1987, we published a paper in this rather prestigious journal that is called EMBO. EMBO stands for European Molecular Biology Organization. It is part of the Nature Publishing Group. And here we describe the role of the interconnections between neurons, the effect of neurotransmitters, and the basic mechanism of memory. And then I kept on doing research on the field of neuroscience, learning, and memory for many, many years, until in 2014, together with the late Dr. Jeff Brestreet, a world authority in the field of autism, and my wife and colleague Stefania Pacini, we published again in a journal that pertains to the Nature Publishing Group, Frontiers in Human Neuroscience, where for the very first time we describe a novel technique using ultrasounds to assess the lesions in the brain of autistic children and how these lesions correlate with the severity of the symptoms and possibly how we can address those lesions as well as the symptoms. Now, here you see me in front of a microscope where human neurons are cultured in a petri dish, in this case on a glass slip, because in the year 2015, we had some very interesting observations and we published a number of papers in the field of neurosciences that I wish to briefly describe. In the beginning of 2015, we described the role of a gene that is difficult to pronounce, RUNX2, and its a role in the evolution of the human brain from primates to humans. And in the same early days of 2015, before I came to the United States, we described how a protein which activates macrophages, and it is called the GC, macrophage activating factor, or GCMF, was able to counteract the damage inflicted by heavy metals to human neurons. And this is important because, as we will see later, heavy metals are implicated in the pathogenesis, if not in the cause of Alzheimer's disease. And shortly thereafter, we published another paper how we demonstrate how this protein, together with oleic acid, another molecule that will be mentioned later on, was effective on the macrophages of the human brain that are called glial cells, or to be more precise, a human microglia. And just in the last days of 2015, we published a paper demonstrating the effect of ultrasounds, those ultrasounds that you use to do ultrasonography as a daily routine in radiology, on the human neurons and microglial cells. But most likely, the most important achievement that we had in the year 2015, and most likely in the entire career of mine, was this paper that we published together with the late Dr. Jeff Brestreet, and that will be heralded as a landmark scientific research at the conference on autism that will be held in Chicago at the end of May. This paper published again in the journal Frontiers in Neuroscience, where we elucidate the pathogenesis of autism, which means we put forward an hypothesis explaining how does autism develop and hopefully how we can address this dreadful disease. And of course, together with my good friend Peter Greenlaw, who is participating in this call tonight, we also published a paper where we described not only what happens inside our heads, in our first brain, but also what happens in our gut, our second brain, as well as in our third brain. As of today, we also know there is a fourth brain, so we have so many brains that we may lose count. And this, of course, is not a scientific book and not a scientific article, not a peer review article like those before, but it may be some interesting reading. Let's talk now about Alzheimer's disease. First of all, let's give some definition. Of course, this disease is named after the German psychiatrist Alois Alzheimer, who first described this pathology in the early years of the 20th century. It accounts for 60 to 70% of all cases of dementia. And in 2015, it was estimated that there were approximately 48 million people worldwide with the Alzheimer's disease. And it begins most often in people who are over 65 years of age, even though there is a small percentage of cases where Alzheimer may begin earlier. And it affects a considerable number of people, 6% of all people 65 years and older. And considering that the world population, unfortunately, is aging because we are fighting a number of diseases, we're talking about millions and millions of people. Unfortunately, the problem is not only that you lose your memory. Problem is that Alzheimer's disease is a deadly disease. And in 2010, this disease accounted for about almost half a million of deaths. In developed countries, it is one of the most financially costly diseases, and it is a chronic neurodegenerative disease that usually starts slowly and gets worse over time. And as we all know, the most common early symptoms is difficulty in remembering recent events, a short-term memory loss. As the disease advances, the symptoms can include problems with language, disorientation, including easily getting lost, mood swings, loss of motivation, not managing self-care, and behavioral issues. And as the person's conditions decline, they often withdraw from family and society. Gradually, bodily functions are lost, ultimately leading to death. So again, it's a deadly disease. Because although the speed of progression can vary, the average life expectancy following the diagnosis ranges from 3 to 9 years. The cause of the Alzheimer's disease is not known. Here we say it's poorly understood, but to be honest, it is not known. And it is assumed that about 70% of the risk is genetic, but no one knows which are the genes that are involved. Other risk factors are rather generic, like a history of head injuries, depression, or hypertension. And the initial symptoms are often mistaken for normal aging. And again, we see an overlapping of symptoms between physiological aging and Alzheimer's disease. Mental and physical exercise and avoiding obesity may decrease the risk of Alzheimer's disease, but again, these are generic recommendations, nothing specific. And as of today, the official viewpoint is that there are no medications or supplements that may decrease the risk, and no treatments stop or reverse its progression, though some treatments may temporarily improve the symptoms. Now, there are several hypotheses concerning the cause or the causes of Alzheimer's disease, and it is important to mention them if we want to understand where research is moving and what could be some breakthrough in the very near future. The oldest hypothesis that was postulated in 1991 is called amyloid hypothesis. Amyloid are proteins. They're called extracellular beta amyloid, proteins that are abnormal. And they deposit, and it was believed for 25 years that they were the fundamental cause of the disease. A few years ago, in 2009, this theory was updated, suggesting that this deposition of these aberrant proteins actually begins very early in life, very early in the brain, during the fast growth phase of early life. And then something happens later in life while we age, and this potential damage is brought to the light. So again, we see a connection with aging. But this is not the only hypothesis. There is another hypothesis involving another protein, which is called tau protein. And it is hypothesized that abnormalities in this protein initiate the cascade of the disease. In this hypothesis, this protein is hyperphosphorylated, and eventually these aberrant proteins form tangles inside the bodies of the nerve cells or neurons. And when this occurs, the structures inside the cells disintegrate and destroy the structure of the cytoskeleton of the cell. And the neuron transport system through which the neurotransmitters travel collapses. And in the end, this will result in the death of the cells, the so-called apoptosis of the cells, and of course, no communication between neurons may occur. But there are also other hypotheses. There is an hypothesis that takes into consideration the functioning of the blood-brain barrier. It is called the neurovascular hypothesis. And as I had mentioned in the introduction, there is also an hypothesis that takes into account the cellular homeostasis, that means equilibrium, of biometals such as copper, iron, and zinc. And in a sense, the control by the cells of these metals is disrupted. And as of today, we don't know whether this is a cause or effect, but nevertheless, the involvement of biometals is hypothesized. Now, these biometals, they cause oxidative stress, and oxidative stress may contribute to the progression of the pathology. And some studies show that increased risk is associated with environmental factors. And again, metals, heavy metals that are almost ubiquitous, such as aluminum. Smoking, cigarette smoking, is a significant risk factor for Alzheimer's disease. And also an involvement of the immune system has been hypothesized. And together with smoking, also air pollution is believed to be a contributing factor to the development and progression of Alzheimer's disease. But I think that you realize that all these factors are rather generic, and they're definitely not specific for Alzheimer's disease. And this tells us that more or less we don't know for sure what triggers and what worsen the progression of the disease. Now, what we know since the times of Dr. Alzheimer is what happens during the disease. What happens is that we lose neurons and synapses. Synapses are connections between neurons. So in the end, we have many less neurons, many less nerve cells. And this doesn't happen in all the areas of the brain, but it is specific to certain certain areas of the brain. And in medical terms, this is called atrophy. Atrophy means lack of tissue, lack of cells. And this, of course, can be observed in several parts of the brain, including the temporal lobe, where memories, learning and memories are under control, the parietal lobe and the frontal cortex and other areas like the cingulate gyrus. Now, this is a picture that is taken from Wikipedia, and it's very explicative because it shows you the size of a normal brain and the size of the brain of a subject with Alzheimer's. So you see the extreme shrinkage of all the areas of the cortex, and particularly the shrinkage of this tiny area that is the hippocampus, that area that I was studying since 1987. Why? Because again, as I say, the hippocampus is critical in the retrieval of memories, is critical in the processes of learning and memories. Now, according to the traditional hypothesis of the accumulation of this aberrant protein that is called amyloid, this accumulation triggers a neuron degeneration. And this protein, this aberrant protein, appears to be toxic, and it disrupts the channels that work for calcium channeling in the cells. In the end, this aberrant toxic protein leads to the programmed cell death or apoptosis. That is a topic we have already covered in our previous talk about 1 week ago. But there is also something that is closely related to nutrition. It has been observed now for several years that people with Alzheimer's at variance with people of the same age are unable to use glucose. So sugar, that is a good fuel for the nerve cells in our brain, cannot be used by the cells of people with Alzheimer's. Whereas control of the same age, they can use the sugar. So this means that the brain cells of Alzheimer's patients, they are deprived of a primary source of energy, which is glucose or sugar. And this is it is hypothesized that this is because the amyloid protein builds up in the mitochondria. So again, I think this is an important concept, that the cells in the brain of Alzheimer's patients cannot use glucose to produce energy for their metabolism. And therefore, they are continuously starved, and in many cases, they are starved to death. And therefore, of course, you lose them and they cannot work. And of course, there is the participation of inflammation and cytokines that may have a role in the pathology of Alzheimer's disease. As we know, inflammation is a general marker of tissue damage, not only in the brain, but in all tissues and in any disease. And we don't know whether it is primary or secondary to the tissue damage, or it is a marker of immunological response. But there is an increasing evidence that there is a strong interrelationship between the neurons and the immunological mechanisms in the brain. And this leads to the discovery that we made with Jeff Brestreet and Stefania Pacini, describing the role of inflammation in another neurodevelopmental disease that has little to do with Alzheimer's, which is autism. Again, in this paper that will be deeply described at the conference Autism One in May, we describe how the infection or inflammation of the deep cervical nodes may lead to impaired lymphatic drainage, with the accumulation of fluid in the brain, and the accumulation of fluid leads to disruption of the connections between neurons and glial cells. Now, as we have said at the beginning, aging per se represents a risk factor for Alzheimer's disease. And according to this review that was published in July of 2015, the study and the identification of pathways within the biology of aging represent an important endpoint for the development of novel and effective disease-modifying drugs to treat, delay, or prevent Alzheimer's disease. I want to repeat, according to this paper that you can retrieve in PubMed, Understanding the biology of aging represents an important endpoint for the development of novel and effective disease-modifying drugs that may treat, delay, or prevent Alzheimer's. And which are these pathways? I think this may resonate something in some of you, because according to this paper, cellular senescence and telomere shortening represent suitable and promising targets. And several studies show that cellular senescence is tightly interconnected to aging and to Alzheimer's disease. I guess you know something about telomeres and telomerase. If you don't, just go to Wikipedia and look for the work of Dr. Bill Andrews. Dr. Bill Andrews has been working on telomerase, which is an enzyme that prevents the shortening of telomeres, and in the end, we may say prevents aging. As a matter of fact, his company has the motto, cure aging or die trying. And he has done a lot of research, and together with Mr. John Anderson, they have developed products that work on this enzyme telomerase and prevent the shortening of telomeres. Am I saying that these products are cure for Alzheimer's? No, I'm not saying this, but I invite you to take a look at the composition of this, at the supplement facts that you can easily retrieve, and you may find something interesting, something that has been described for the past 2,000 years. As a matter of fact, just a few months ago, in 2015, this author from Melbourne, Australia, published in PubMed, so we are talking about peer review papers of the highest quality standard, this article that is entitled Brain Food for Alzheimer-Free Aging, Focus on Herbal Medicines. And essentially what he writes is, healthy brain aging and the problems of dementia and Alzheimer's disease are global concerns. Beyond 60 years of age, most, if not everyone, will experience a decline in cognitive skills, memory capacity, and changes in brain function. Longevity eventually leads to an accumulation of amyloid plaques and or tau tangles, including some vascular dementia damage. Now, he says that plants can be considered as chemical factories that manufacture huge numbers of diverse bioactive substances, many of which have the potential to provide substantial neuroprotective benefits. Medicinal herbs and health food supplements have been widely used in Asia since over 2,000 years. And then he goes on and he describes different medicinal herbs, different botanicals. But again, if you compare what this scientist is describing with what Dr. Bill Andrews and Mr. John Anderson have developed, you will find many, many overlapping features. So we are talking about a knowledge that may prevent aging and hopefully Alzheimer's disease that is known, has been known for about 2,000 years. And let's for example, take only one of these botanicals that are described in that paper, like turmeric. If you go to PubMed, turmeric or curcumin, and you look for turmeric and Alzheimer, you retrieve 58 papers. And the first one, published in December 2015, tells you all, neuroprotective effect of curcumin on endothelin-1-mediated cell death in hippocampal neurons. So again, the hippocampus is a critical area for memories and learning, and how turmeric may prevent the death of these neurons. And talking about death and neuronal cell death and apoptosis, if you go to PubMed and again you look for Alzheimer and apoptosis, this time you retrieve more than 2,000 peer-review articles. And I just remind you that I'd been working on the field of apoptosis. If you look for Ruggiero M and apoptosis, you retrieve 10 papers. Since the mid-80s, when together with my colleagues in at the University of Florence, we realized that there was a relationship between apoptosis, senescence, immortalization, and cancer. And I think we talked about immortalization and cancer in our previous talk. Now, this study, it's very interesting in my opinion. First of all, this study was published only a few days ago, we could say, because it was published in February 2016. So again, I'm presenting not only state of the art, but very, very recent research. Now, this study investigated whether abnormal apoptotic events, which means abnormal cell death, beside the non-involvement in the cells of our brain, may also occur in the platelets. Platelets are small cells in our bloodstream that are useful to prevent hemorrhages. They form blood clots. So essentially, these scientists, they had the idea that platelets that have nothing to do with neurons may show the same signs of abnormal cell death that are observed inside inside the heads of people with Alzheimer's. And again, it's interesting to notice that I began to work on platelets since the mid-80s when I was at the Burroughs Wellcome Laboratory in North Carolina. Now, these authors, they pinpoint to a particular gene that we described in detail in our previous talk that is called BCL2. BCL2 is a gene that controls cell death, and when it is properly upregulated, it may lead to immortalization. It may also lead to cancer, so it is a double-edged sword, but definitely it is called the gene of immortalization. Well, these authors, they observed that in the early onset of Alzheimer's disease, when the symptoms are not yet clear, if you simply draw some blood and if you look for aberrant apoptosis in platelets, you will find it. So again, this could be very instrumental in the future for the early diagnosis of Alzheimer's, and Alzheimer's, like all diseases, when it is diagnosed at an early stage, of course, it is easier to be challenged rather than when it is diagnosed at a late stage. And again, I remember you that together with John Anderson, we published an entire chapter on this gene of immortality, BCL2, in the Encyclopedia of Cancer just a few weeks ago, a gene that I had been working with for the past 25 years. And hopefully this may lead to some product that addresses exactly this gene and its role in immortalization. Now, this gentleman here is a Nobel laureate, Otto Warburg, the discoverer of this so-called Warburg effect and the role of ketones or ketone bodies in a number of conditions. He was mainly focused on cancer, but now we know that ketone bodies and these so-called ketogenic diets, they may be useful in a number of different conditions in addition to cancer itself. Now, as I told you during the description of the features of Alzheimer's, neurons in the brain of patients with Alzheimer's are unable to use glucose for their energy requirements. As a paper published in January of 2016, so again, a few weeks ago, in the Annals of the New York Academy of Science, says, brain glucose uptake is impaired in Alzheimer's disease. And the key question is whether the cognitive decline can be delayed if we give some alternative source of energy to those neurons. Again, these neurons are starving to death, not because the patient is not eating enough sugar, because the neurons are unable to use that sugar. So what if we give to those neurons some other type of food, some other type of fuel? And these other type of food or fuel are the ketone bodies, beta-hydroxybutyrate and acetoacetate, that are the brain's main physiological alternative fuel to glucose. And there are three studies that have demonstrated that at variance with glucose, the brain ketone uptake is not different from that in a healthy age matched control. This means the brain of Alzheimer's patients is unable to use the glucose. And because of this, the neurons starve to death. But these very same neurons, they are very able to use an alternative source of energy that are the ketone bodies. And so now it becomes rather clear that published clinical trials demonstrate that increasing the availability of ketones to the brain through a moderate nutritional ketosis has a beneficial effect on cognitive outcomes. And how do you achieve a nutritional ketosis? Well, now I will tell you something that again will resonate something with your knowledge. First of all, you have to supplement a high-fat ketogenic diet that is rich in medium-chain triglycerides, essentially like coconut oil. And this paper published in January 2016 states that given the acute dependence of the brain on its energy supply, which is rather obvious, without food, without energy, cells die, it seems reasonable that the development of therapeutic strategies aimed at Alzheimer's disease mandates consideration of how the underlying problem of deteriorating brain fuel supply can be corrected or delayed. In other words, they say quite clearly that clinical studies demonstrate that if you give to the brain of Alzheimer's patients the fuel that they can use, that are the ketone bodies, you can definitely improve the outcome of the disease. And intermittent fasting, something that many of you are familiar with, is an excellent way to achieve the moderate ketosis. And let's take a look at this article that is not so novel since it was published 2 years ago in May 2014, describing the effects of intermittent fasting in animal and human studies. Let me read very rapidly. IF stands for intermittent fasting regimens have been demonstrated to induce a multitude of positive impacts on age-related diseases in animal studies, including the attenuation or prevention of diabetes and cardiovascular disease and increasing the maximal lifespan. In animal studies, old rats subjected to intermittent fasting exhibited enhanced memory. Why? Simply because they began producing ketone bodies, the fuel for the brain cells. And this study by Vahleo and co-authors demonstrated that intermittent fasting increased measures of health span and lifespan, proving its feasibility in human subjects. However, as of today, there are no studies on the impact of intermittent fasting upon Alzheimer's disease on human subjects. Many studies on animals, but very few studies on human subjects. So there are many studies on the benefits of the intermittent fasting on a number of other conditions, ranging from obesity, diabetes, cancer, but as yet there are not such studies in Alzheimer's disease, even though it seems logical, as they wrote in the Annals of the New York Academy of Science, that moderate ketosis, as it is achieved with intermittent fasting, may improve the condition of Alzheimer's patients, as well as may slow down the cognitive decline that we all experience with age. Let me introduce very briefly this wonderful doctor, Dr. Mary Newport, whose husband developed Alzheimer's at an early age. She's the author of a number of serious academic papers published in peer-reviewed journals that you can retrieve in PubMed, like this one, A New Way to Produce Hyperketonemia. But also she wrote a wonderful and lovely book, Alzheimer's Disease, What If There Was a Cure, describing her experience, her successful experience with her husband. So again, we have a number of evidences pointing to the benefits of intermittent fasting and a ketogenic diet in the prevention and in the management of brain aging as well as Alzheimer's disease. There is, however, a small or big but. A big but that we described in this paper that we published in 2015, dealing with a ketogenic diet in cancer. So in this paper published in Anti-Cancer Research, we don't deal with Alzheimer's disease, but we deal with the issue of a ketogenic diet. Now, ketogenic diets, such as those that may be achieved through intermittent fasting, alternating fasting and cleansing, they may have some side effects. And one of the side effects is that, the major side effect as we write here, is that you may incur in vitamin D3 deficiency, something that had been observed in children that were subjected to a ketogenic diet to control epilepsy. So essentially, if you embark in an intermittent fasting regime, if you embark in a ketogenic, moderate ketogenic diet, you have to consider the supplementation of proteins and supplements containing vitamin D3. Now, this leads to an interesting observation. There are on the market several protein shakes. Some of them, they have been designed for professionals. They're called Pro. And these protein shakes, they have a number of advantages because not only they contain valuable source of energy, but they also contain a number of supplements, vitamins, including the vitamin D3, plus something that may be even more useful if, but only if, you give to the enzymes, proteases, and so on that are contained in these shakes the time to work. So let me explain a little bit. If you take dry milk or whey protein as it is, it has not a very good nutritional value. The utilization of nitrogen to build your own proteins is rather poor. But if to these protein shakes that are essentially made of whey protein and dry milk, you add vitamins, of course, is something good you may need. But also if you add enzymes like proteases and you give them the time to work, essentially by letting the shake sitting at room temperature after you have dissolved it in water with no ice for 30-45 minutes, then you obtain two very welcome effects. First of all, you greatly increase the utilization of nitrogen. So instead of being below 20%, now raises above 80 or 90%. But this may not be the main beneficial effect.
Dr. Franco?
Yes.
Can I just get you to unplug your headset and plug it back in, because we're getting some static, and I think it happened last week as well. Because I want people, if you can repeat what you just mentioned about the letting the shake sit and the effect on that.
What about now?
Thank you.
All right, so let's go back to the time it needs, time it takes for the shakes to express all their beneficial properties. As I said, if you take simply whey protein and dry milk, the nutritional value is rather poor, because the net nitrogen utilization, a concept by Professor Luca Moretti, that is the amount of nitrogen that is used to build your own proteins, is rather poor, below 20%. But if those shakes, in addition to vitamins that are required, such as vitamin D3, they also contain enzymes that are called proteases, and you let them work for the proper amount of time, that is, you dissolve the shakes that are under the form of a powder into water with no ice, you let it sit for 30-45 minutes at room temperature, and then you drink it, then it happens that the proteases, by clipping the long proteins and reducing them to small peptides, they significantly increase the utilization of nitrogen that goes up to 80 or 90%. But this may not be the most beneficial effect. The most beneficial effect may be another one. That is, medium chain triglycerides like coconut oil that are extremely beneficial for the production of ketone bodies, unfortunately, they have some side effect. They are not so healthy for the circulatory system. So you may want to protect your circulatory system when you embark in an intermittent fasting ketogenic diet. And guess what? The hydrolysis, which means the degradation of casein, which is the main protein in dry milk and whey, produces three peptides, which are like very, very small proteins made by only three amino acids. And these three peptides, they stimulate the production of nitric oxide by endothelial cells. This means that if you let the shakes sit for 30, 45 minutes, not only you greatly increase their nutritional value, but you also produce these small peptides that through their action mediated by the nitric oxide are extremely protective against cardiovascular diseases. So you don't run the risk of inducing any unhealthy effects due to the medium chain triglycerides. In other words, if you simply let the time pass and the enzyme work, you achieve a number of healthy effects that go well beyond and above the nutritional properties of those shakes. Now it's time for a change. Change of topic, of course. And let me introduce something that is truly revolutionary. And here I am taking an example, the encyclical letter of the Pope Leo XIII at the end of the 19th century, when he introduced revolutionary change, and since the encyclical letter is written in Latin, it is called Rerum Novarum, which means revolutionary change. And so I take the liberty of using this analogy to introduce revolutionary changes in our approach to neurological conditions such as Alzheimer's disease. And so I have to introduce another actor in this drama or play that happens inside our heads every time that we let our brain function. And this other actor is nobody else than an old acquaintance of mine, cells of the immune system called macrophages, the sentinels of the immune system, cells that I had been working with since the early 90s when I was working at the National Cancer Institute in Bethesda, Maryland, and together with my colleague, we published this paper on the stimulation of macrophages with this protein called the macrophage colony stimulating factor, or CSF1, in this case, again, in the context of neoplasia or cancer. Now, in August of 2015, a truly seminal paper was published in the journal named Brain, describing the fundamental role of macrophages or monocytes, they are the same type of cells, in Alzheimer's disease. Essentially, this paper described how recent studies indicate that increased cerebral infiltration of monocytes, either by enriching, that is increasing their numbers in the circulation, or by weekly immunization, resulted in substantial attenuation of disease progression in an animal model of Alzheimer's by mechanisms that involved enhanced cellular uptake and enzymatic degradation of the toxic protein that is the beta amyloid, as well as regulation of brain inflammation. So what does this mean? These authors demonstrate that the macrophages, the sentinels of the immune system, they play a fundamental role also inside our brains. And when you increase their number and their activity in your bloodstream, they go and look for the disease also inside the brain, and essentially they take care of the toxic amyloid proteins and they decrease the inflammation in the brain. So the point is, how do we stimulate the macrophages. How do we increase their numbers? How do we increase their activities? Until about 1 year ago, we had a wonderful candidate, a protein that is called GCMAF, GC macrophage activating factor. Whether this is true or not, I'm considered a world expert in this protein. I published 7 papers, peer-reviewed, that you can retrieve in PubMed on this protein. And also, I was somehow, my research was reported in this British journal that is entitled What Doctors Don't Tell You, where the GCMAF, the superhero for your health problems, it is in the front cover, and you can go and look at the story of my research with GCMAF, probiotics, and so on in this article. However, there is also in this case a big however. This protein that received so much attention, even by the famous author, Dr. John Gray, who wrote a wonderful foreword in the book The Third Brain that we wrote together with Peter Greenlaw. You can read the foreword in Amazon, so you don't need to buy the book to read the foreword by Dr. John Gray. However, this protein has been banned. It was in February, on the 3rd of February of 2015, when the British health authorities and then all the health authorities all over the world, they banned the use of this protein in clinics. So the protein still can be studied, but for a variety of reasons, it cannot be used to prevent or treat any disease. And just because of this, and being a so-called expert on this protein and on this mechanism of action, it was in those days, that is before I came to the United States, that I began to develop an alternative to stimulate the macrophages to obtain the very same identical results that we and others had observed for years with the old GCMAF that had been banned, but this time with something that is more powerful, more versatile, and definitely safer. And what I had developed in those years and months is a most advanced evolution of the GCMAF that derives from a research that began in my early days of research in 1985, so 31 years ago, and had continued with collaborations in Europe, USA, and Japan for more than 30 years. So this is a print screen of the first paper I published on these molecules in 1985 in the Biochemical Journal that in those days was printed in Great Britain. And this observation or discovery or development is based on the knowledge of the molecular structure of the GCMAF that we helped elucidating in this paper that we published in 2015, just before I came to the United States. Now, I know that molecular biology can be rather boring, and I won't go into the details of the molecular structure of the GCMAF, that is a very complex one. I will simply enumerate the active sites. Molecules, like many other things, they have parts that are useless and are parts that are very active. Now, the active sites of the GCMAF are a sugar that is called N-acetylgalactosamine, the vitamin D, the oleic acid, and the glycosaminoglycan that is called chondroitin sulfate, that, by the way, as Wikipedia rightly states, is made by alternating sugars of N-acetylgalactosamine and glucuronic acid. Now, what I discovered is that each one of these molecules that constitute the active site shows potential usefulness in Alzheimer's disease and in neurological and neurodevelopmental disorders such as autism, for example. And let's have a brief overview of each one of these molecules that constitute the active site of the GCMAF. And let's start with chondroitin sulfate. Since 1997, it was demonstrated that actually chondroitin sulfate stimulates the macrophages through this macrophage colony stimulating factor. And in 2010, it was demonstrated, let's read it together, Experimental and clinical data suggest that chondroitin sulfate may be a useful therapeutic agent in diseases such as inflammatory bowel diseases, atherosclerosis, Parkinson and Alzheimer's disease, multiple sclerosis, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, and lupus. So essentially, it is mentioning this paper, the potential use of chondroitin sulfate in all neurological conditions. And we now know since August 2014, that chondroitin sulfate contributes to the development of the brain, to the repair of injuries, and also to the fight against cancer. And chondroitin sulfate regulates the immunity inside the central nervous system. And as far as Alzheimer and amyloid accumulation are concerned, this paper of 2010 tells us that chondroitin sulfate inhibits the apoptosis induced by the beta amyloid. In other words, the chondroitin sulfate inhibits the death of the cells in Alzheimer's patients that is induced by the accumulation of this aberrant protein that is the beta amyloid. And what about oleic acid? Well, oleic acid has been known for decades that improves the outcome of Alzheimer's both in cellular and animal models, simply because this is one of the healthiest oils that we can use in human nutrition. And what about vitamin D? If you go and look for vitamin D and Alzheimer's, you retrieve a number of papers. I just took this one as an example that concludes, and this was published 1 year ago in January 2015, vitamin D supplementation caused significant improvement in the cognitive performance in subjects with senile dementia. Now, in biochemistry, when we do the math, it's rather different than when we do the math in daily life. In other words, you may think, okay, I'm convinced all the hard science points the usefulness of these four molecules, the N-acetylgalactosamine, the chondroitin sulfate, the vitamin D, and the oleic acid, in slowing or preventing brain aging and possibly in the management of Alzheimer's. So why don't I simply go at the grocery store and buy supplements containing chondroitin sulfate? You can find as many as you wish, vitamin D, buy some extra virgin olive oil rich in oleic acid. Chondroitin sulfate is rich in N-acetylgalactosamine, so you don't need to buy it separately. Why don't I simply mix them together, eat or drink them, and I'm good? Well, unfortunately, you are good, but you're not as good as you could be if you found the way, as I did, to combine these four molecules in one single supramolecular structure. That is a molecule that mimics what happens in nature, where these four active components, they are bound together via non-covalent bonds. So the math that we do is that when vitamin D and oleic acid are bound together, as they're in nature, to chondroitin sulfate, without the need of any GCMF protein, since the backbone or the carrier is the chondroitin sulfate, we have the three components in a single supramolecular assembly, and this amplifies their respective biological effects. So if you simply go and buy the three components separately, and assuming that their biological effect is 10, in the end you have an addition and you have an end result of 30. But if you bind them through non-covalent bonds in a single supramolecular structure, you multiply their respective potencies and your end biological effect is 1,000. So how did I do? Well, these are just examples. For example, on the upper part of the slide, you see the chemical composition of chondroitin sulfate, which is a rather hydrophilic molecule. Hydrophilic means it solubilizes in water. Oleic acid, vice versa, is oil. So you may think these two molecules will never want to stay together. Well, that's not absolutely true, because if you manage to combine this methyl group that is rather hydrophobic with this double bond here, you have a point of connection. And also, The oleic acid is nevertheless an acid. So it has an acidic moiety here, the carboxyl group, and you can combine this with the amino group of the galactosamine on the chondroitin sulfate. So here you have hydrophilic, hydrophobic bonds. So it's a very complex interaction. And something similar, albeit different in chemical nature, may occur when I combined the chondroitin sulfate with the vitamin D3. So this is the carboxyl group in the chondroitin sulfate, and this is the hydroxyl, that is basic, group in the vitamin D3. And here you can see this methyl group, hydrophobic, in the chondroitin sulfate, finding its way in this pocket of two hydrophobic methyl groups in the vitamin D3, and also in this other pocket of two hydrophobic methyl groups in the vitamin D3. So it's a very complex, it was not easy at all to find the way to combine molecules so different, but the end result was a supramolecular structure that is extremely effective in activating the macrophages, increasing their numbers, and according to that paper that I just mentioned before, with an extremely great potential in preventing brain aging and possibly, hopefully, in the management of Alzheimer. As a matter of fact, the Mayo Clinic in itself, when it describes the facts about drugs and supplements, and describes, for example, the uses based on traditional theory for chondroitin sulfate, Alzheimer disease is one of the first. And of course, also, as far as vitamin D is concerned, and the Mayo Clinic writes, higher blood levels of vitamin D3 are associated with better mental performance in people with Alzheimer disease, and weekly dietary intake of vitamin D has been linked to better mental performance in older women. And of course, more studies are always required. Now, I'm very close to the end of my talk, and I want to mention you some future perspectives. It was only a few weeks ago when in Australian journals, and they were followed by journals all over the world, a breakthrough research was described reporting the effects of ultrasounds. This is a common ultrasound system that many doctors use for the diagnosis of a number of conditions. Ultrasounds could be used in the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. And as a matter of fact, if you go to PubMed and you look for ultrasounds and Alzheimer's disease, you retrieve 54 papers. And the first one, it's interesting because it tells you ultrasound treatment of neurological diseases, current and emerging applications. I just would like to remind you that I began working on ultrasounds and the brain in 2012 when I published this paper describing this is the brain of a subject, I think it's my own brain, studied with the ultrasounds in the context of the chronic fatigue syndrome or myalgic encephalomyelitis. And it was rather interesting to notice that Professor Ameroff, Stuart Ameroff, works not very far from here, from where I'm sitting now, about 2 hours southeast in Tucson at the University of Arizona, at exactly the same time, that is in the first months of 2012, published this paper that is the effect of transcranial ultrasonography on mental states. And this is Professor Stu Amerson, this is his brain, this is myself, and this is my brain. So more or less they look the same. There is a big difference, however, between the procedure that Professor Ameroff developed and the procedure that I developed. That is, as you can see, he is not looking at the screen. This means that he cannot exploit the so-called biofeedback. By looking at the screen, I can exploit the biofeedback effect that is extremely powerful in a number of neurological and mental conditions. And as I told you, in 2015, we published 2 papers that you can retrieve in PubMed. This is one, and the next one is the second one, describing now how the ultrasounds affect the function of the human neurons and the human microglial cells that I repeat, microglial cells are like the macrophages in the brain in vitro. So these two papers lay the foundation for the development of dedicated machines. In other words, not the machines that are used for general purposes like those, but dedicated machines for the treatment of brain aging, of neurological, neurodevelopmental conditions, including Alzheimer's. So thanks to the results reported in these papers, now we are able to develop dedicated machines that hopefully will truly help people to exploit these effects of the ultrasounds. And finally, and this is for real the last slide, I could talk for hours and hours, but I will not do it today, about the role of the microbiome, the third brain, and now we know the fourth brain as well, in Alzheimer's disease, as well as in brain aging and brain function. But I think that this topic is so huge that maybe if Lori wants to invite me another time, we can cover this topic another time, because there are so many things that we can say about the role of the microbiome. As you may know, I, together with my wife, had developed a microbiome reconstituting product that is already proving extremely useful in the management of autism and a number of other neurological diseases. But as I said, this topic is so vast that it will take definitely another hour, and I think you're all very tired. So I stop it here. I thank you so much for your attention. And now I will stop sharing the screen, and I am ready for all your questions and answers. Thank you so much.
Oh my gosh. I have like 6 pages of notes, and I am not tired at all. This is unbelievably exciting information. And what I'm getting as my takeaway before I open it up is that minerals and vitamins and herbs, things that have existed since the dawn of time, you know, is what the method is. It's not medications, that healing the brain and really nourishing the brain is the area of research that you've been instrumental in. And that is so exciting, because it's something that's accessible for everybody. And I really want to thank you. This was so easy to understand, so beyond exciting. And I can't wait to go and explore some more of the research. So thank you, thank you, thank you. And what I'd like to do right now is feedback, takeaways, comments for Dr. Ruggiero, and anything you'd like to ask in terms of clarification. This is your chance. Unmute your line. Please say your name so we know who you are. And then I guess who would like to jump out first?
Lori, Peter Greenlaw, I just want to clarify one thing. Dr. Ruggiero talked about allowing the shakes to sit for the time. I believe, maybe I didn't hear him, but it's also temperature is a critical component. It needs to be ideally at 100 degrees or room temperature works. No ice, no cold water. It must be room temperature, 100 degrees. In order for the proteases to work, they need both time and temperature. So I just wanted to clarify that one point that I'm not sure was clarified. And now I'll mute myself again.
Actually, thanks for that, Peter. And that was actually, I'm glad you reiterated that, because that was when the line got a little bit crackly and we went over it again. But that is so important to make sure time and temperature.
Yes, I fully agree.
Hi, this is Anke, Lori.
Hi, Anke.
Hi. I have a question in regards to the last part. This was an awesome presentation, even though my brain is fuming right now because I'm not a scientist. But towards the end, Dr. Ruggiero mentioned that the importance of this product that he created that binds the chondroit sulfate, the vitamin D3, and the oleic acids. Is that part of the shakes that we are already consuming, or is that something new that we should be looking forward to?
Is something absolutely new. And of course, since this talk is a scientific talk, is not an advertising, I will not mention names, but just look at what the Pope wrote, and you will find clues to what I'm talking about. So this is a new product that has nothing to do with the existing products that you know, because it is absolutely new. It was developed about 1 year ago before I came to the United States, but it is on the market since only the end of December of last year. So it's something new you have to look for. So a little bit of mental exercise will keep your neurons healthy.
Thank you.
You're quite welcome.
I have a question.
Please.
The question is, I work with clients with strokes, MS, and a lot of the things, and dementia and Alzheimer's. And I do exercises with system balancing and what we're stimulating the brain, getting the central nervous system stimulated, and it helps them get great gains. Do you think that kind of work actually helps keep the brain younger?
Well, I don't know this, but what I know is that many therapists have observed what you are reporting, for example, in autism. So I know that autism is different than the diseases you have mentioned, but nevertheless, it appears that many of, if not all, neurologic conditions, they have something in common. That is brain inflammation. Brain inflammation due to disruption of the internal brain immunity that in turn is due to a blockade of the lymphatic drainage through this newly discovered brain lymphatic vessel. To make it very short, here inside our necks, right here, we have some lymph nodes that are called deep cervical nodes. They drain the lymph from the nose, the mouth, and the throat, and very easily they become infected. Point is that also the lymph from the brain that was completely unrecognized and unknown until a few months ago drains in those nodes. So every time you have inflammation or infection in your nose, throat, or mouth, those lymph nodes are clogged. And because of this, the lymph from the brain cannot drain properly, accumulates, and toxins, metabolites, and harmful microbes, they also accumulate, and the recirculation of macrophages cannot occur. So a number of empirical treatments that have been proven efficacious in the past, for example, let me mention craniosacral therapy, that therapists had observed was efficient, but nobody knew why. Well, now we know that a number of empirical treatments, when I say empirical, I say we know they work, but we don't know why or how they work, now are becoming clear. So most likely what you are observing is due to the fact that somehow you improve the circulation of the lymph to and from the brain. And of course, I cannot say, there is no research demonstrating that this will keep the brain younger, but definitely this will keep the brain healthier. And I think that this in itself is a good achievement.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I have a question actually about the earlier in the talk about the nutritional ketosis.
Mm-hmm.
And it is, you mentioned that nutritional ketosis can improve the life quality of Alzheimer patients, or also work as a preventative maintenance, I guess, against getting Alzheimer's. And then you tied it into intermittent fasting as a way of achieving nutritional ketosis. So in our nutrition program, we have a cleanse day that we do, and some people do too. Would that be considered fasting?
Yes, it will be considered fasting. Actually, fasting, what in your program you call cleansing, but it is nothing else than intermittent fasting, is the best way to rapidly achieve ketosis. for example, in the management of cancer, where you want to achieve not a moderate, but a very significant ketosis, fasting for 1 or 2 days is absolutely mandatory. Of course, during those one or two days, you have to drink a lot. And if you drink detoxifying agents, all the better. And you want to keep on drinking detoxifying or cleansing agents during the period of ketosis. Now, moderate ketosis can be maintained for life. And actually, it has been demonstrated that it increases not only the length of life, but also the quality of life. So the intermittent fasting is one of the best way to maintain a moderate ketosis. If you want, at some point in time, you may be curious to learn whether you're truly inducing ketosis or not. So just go to the grocery store and buy one of those strips that measure blood ketone bodies or blood ketones that diabetics use. There are these little devices. Abbott, for example, is a major pharmaceutical company. They make devices to measure blood ketones. Are those very little portable devices that diabetics use to monitor their blood glucose and blood ketones. So you may want to check for yourself if you're curious. The level of ketones in a person who is not in ketosis is below 0.5. When you go above 0.5, then you are in a state of ketosis, which means that you're not feeding your cancer cells. And please remember that we all have cancer cells in our body since the time we are born. So to be in a moderate ketosis, it is beneficial for the prevention of cancer, which is good in itself. But also, you will be feeding your neurons in your brain with the best available food for them, that are the ketone bodies. When you enter ketosis, you will experience a number of positive effects. Your cognition will be sharper. Your attention will be improved. Your ability to perform tasks will improve. So it's not like the magic pill of limitless, but definitely it's a significant improvement in all your neurological abilities. Something that you will experience only after 1 week of moderate ketosis. Again, if you want to be ultra precise, just buy one of those little devices, they don't cost too much, monitor your blood ketones, and you will see that when your blood ketones are constantly around 1, you will feel, if not like the actor of Limitless, very close.
Okay, so sorry, just to summarize really quickly then, you said medium fasting, or medium, so would that be considered 1 day a week? You do a cleansing or a fasting 1 day a week, would that keep you in a medium range?
I don't think so. Now, don't ask me for individual advice because, of course, I cannot give. It depends on the metabolism of the individual. It depends on the amount of physical activity and so on. Mm. Only 1 day a week, in my opinion, is a little bit too little. But again, I may be wrong. If you simply measure your blood ketones, you may find out that given your overall nutrition, given your level of physical activity, 1 day a week may be enough. Or maybe it's not enough and you need to do 2 days a week. So it's very individual. I cannot tell you right on the spot. But it's very easy to measure. You measure and you find the best regimen for yourself.
Right. Okay, well, thank you very much. That clears it up.
My pleasure.
Dr. Rosario, I have a question. My name is Denise, and for now,
I'm sorry, I cannot hear you.
Oh, no. Hello, can you hear me?
Now, only a little bit. Apparently, your connection is not very fast. Maybe you can switch the camera off so you save some memory.
Let me try. Can you hear me now?
Much better now.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Rosario. Thank you so much for this talk. It was really interesting and wonderful. My family and I are in the throes of Alzheimer's and dementia right now, and I'm not going to ask for any specific individual information. about that, but what I have noticed is the importance of, you talked about sugar and you talked about glucose and how people with Alzheimer's and dementia have trouble with glucose. And that's very true. But what I've noticed is that a lot of people crave it. I know that my mother craves it a lot. And I think it has to do with the fact that this is an old theory, and I just wanted your feedback on it. The theory that many times when people have cholesterol-lowering drugs for many, many years, what happens with that is that their brains do not have the amount of cholesterol or fat that they need over time. And that basically cholesterol and fat, since the brain is 60% fat, and cholesterol actually protects the brain from toxins. Is that true?
Up to a certain extent, yes, it is true, because cholesterol is not the absolute evil that we thought it was. Cholesterol is an extremely important component of the membrane of the cells, of all cells. So again, we don't want to be hypercholesterolemic, otherwise we may have ictus or myocardial infarction. But again, cholesterol is not absolute evil. And from cholesterol, many, many bioactive fats are produced, including vitamins and so on. So yes, essentially you're right. Without entering into biochemical details, you're right.
So the one of the hypotheses is that I have read over the years is that the reason that people are actually craving the sugar is because they don't have enough fat in their system. They're craving something to hold on to. And what we have noticed, at least with my mother, is that doing what you have said, as far as a ketogenic diet, replacing, not even allowing any sugar other than, she would have a sugar craving, we've been replacing it with walnuts or with omega-3s, omega-6s, and also with the undenatured whey proteins. And we have noticed the significant change with the proper nutrients that we've been giving her in her cognitive capacity over the past 2 years. It's been a noticeable improvement that is beyond anything we ever would have expected. So I just want to thank you for talking about nutrition today and really, really putting that point across to people, because even if someone is in the throes of Alzheimer's or dementia, there are ways in which people can actually work with the individuals in a very positive way, and nutrition really, really can help. So I thank you for speaking to that today.
Thank you. Thank you for this wonderful feedback. And this confirms from your empirical experience all what I've said. So there is no better confirmation than the practical experience of people who live with this condition in a daily life. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for what you do.
Anybody else with questions or feedback? I know we're running a little bit over, but I know there's a lot of people with questions that we want to be able to answer. Well, at this point, maybe what I will do then is say thank you on behalf of all of us and those that will be listening to the recording. A huge thank you to the amount of time and preparation that you put in, Marco, for putting this together in such an easy to understand way with a massive volume of research and knowledge. And I know that is one of the gifts that I appreciate so much from you, is that your ability to take incredibly complicated information and break it down to a very simple way for us to be able to understand and really get excited about your passion and what you are bringing to all of us and to everybody in terms of opportunities to really change the way our brains age. So thank you so much. We will be posting the recording up very, very soon.
Well, thank you so much, Laurie, and let me thank all the participants. It has been a pleasure and a honor to be with you tonight. And thanks to these technologies, we can be together as many times as you wish. So I invite each one of you to organize things. I am not knowledgeable about all things, of course. My areas of expertise are only two or three, but in those areas of expertise, I feel that I can contribute to the advancement of knowledge. And so I think it's my duty, my mission in this life to help people with my knowledge. So I thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity, and I hope to be joining you in the very near future.
And I think on that note, I will take you up on that and say that we will continue our interview series on the microbiome, which is your research on the third brain, and with you, and perhaps Peter Greenlaw can come on board as well and share that incredibly fascinating information that is so, so, so relevant today. So yes, please, and thank you, and we will set that up for everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye, and have a good night.
Bye. Awesome call. Thanks.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.